Hey guys, today I'm going to give you a tour of the E4 TBB monitoring unit set up on one of our solar nest units in the warehouse. I'm going to show you the most important parts to look at, settings and ways of monitoring it once you've got it up and running. So, let's have a look. Let's have a look at the different summary panes we have here. So we have one for the battery, usually the most important one. One for the load, this is where you can see what's going out of the batteries or out of the system as a whole. This is the generator, so this is your utility input, your AC input to the unit. Generally this is going to be coming from a generator, this will tell you how much is coming in. Solar, this is going to tell you how much power is coming in at the moment and how much has come through today. Each of these can be clicked on for further information. So once we go in there, you can see a whole lot more details. You can even see it in a graph form. This is all stuff you can also see on the monitoring app. So let's go back out of there, let's have a look at solar. It's not charging much at the moment, just because the batteries are full and we're not drawing any loads. And here we can see the graph as well. You can adjust it by month and year. Now we can see the generator. At the moment we don't have one connected, but normally it would give you all the information from the generator as it's running. And load. This is where you would see what's going out on your AC output circuits. This is the critical or AC output one. We can't change it at the moment because it's currently deactivated, but normally you can click here and you can select the non-critical loads and you can see what that circuit is running as well. So those are all the summaries. Those are the ones you want to keep an eye on throughout every time you come out and have a look at it or you check your phone. These are the main ones to be looking at for what your system's doing. Another one with a lot of utility is actually right in the middle here. You can tap on the inverter itself. This gives you another summary of what's going on with the inverter. Plus, it gives you this handy button here, turn on. If your inverter's off, you can usually just hold the button a couple of seconds to turn it on, or you can do it from here. There you go. So the inverter has just turned on, and you can see that coming up to the right voltage. Every day, the main things you're going to be looking at when you're running off-grid is probably your battery capacity at that moment. That's represented by SOC or state of charge here. At the moment we're at 100%, so we have plenty of charge in the batteries to run our appliances. Ideally, if the system's sized correctly, you're probably going to hit full battery charge on average about once a day, and ideally you're going to have quite a lot left for overnight usage. That means you'll also be keeping an eye on the solar, especially during the day. What you want to see is a healthy amount of generation during the day, especially if you're using it. Don't worry if there isn't so much generation appearing, you might just have full batteries. So that's why it's always good to check that. Another thing you can check is your load panel here. Power output in watts here. This is a 4000 watt continuous inverter charger. That means we don't really want to get too close to the limit. You can monitor how it's going at the moment here. Currently we're not running anything, so we've got 0 watts. Here you can see your consumption over the day. Last thing to keep an eye on is generator. Usually not that important, but if you want to check it's running while it's on and it's actually charging the batteries, you would have a look here and it would say from gen and it would say how much has been charged recently, and your power would be, depending on your generator and depending on how empty your batteries are, you're probably going to see this around 1000 to 3000 watts. You can also check if the generator is running by checking what are the voltages here. Generally, generators are going to be 230 volts AC and about 50 hertz. I've simulated an error here for a demonstration. If we look here and you touch this little red icon, it gives you the error description and the time. Now, you can mute it, but I don't recommend doing that until you've actually resolved the error. This is just an error I've simulated by disconnecting the BMS cable. So if I put it back in, we should see it clear soon. Go out, relay a little bit, there you go. So back to normal. This is gone. So this is what it should look like under normal operation. And look, we can't touch it, we can't tap on it unless there's actually an error present. The next most important thing, especially while you're setting it up, are the settings. You can access them by clicking this little menu icon here. This shows you all the different categories, and most importantly at the beginning, the general settings are what you're going to need to use. This allows you to access all these different types of settings, and once you are setting up your system, we will have a book that you can have a look at that'll show you for different use cases. Most of them are found under working mode, where you can choose how the system's going to operate and prioritize your energy sources. Another setting you'll be interested in when setting this up is the smart port. This is how you control the second AC output on these units to determine when it's going to be on or off. Most of the time, your battery state of charge is what's going to indicate this. Most people use this port for non-essential loads that they'll only run if there's plenty of battery capacity or plenty of solar available. And this allows you to set that up exactly to how you want it. Another important setting is the auxiliary contact port. This is actually how you set up your auto start generator. What conditions will it turn on? Again, state of charge of the batteries is the most common way to set this up. You can also use the trigger now buttons to actually turn the generator on for testing. But here's where you find all of these settings and how you can customize when your generator is going to turn on. Another important one to look at while you're setting it up is the wireless comm. This is actually how you connect the unit to the internet to allow monitoring from your phone or a browser on your computer. This is actually connected to our network at the moment, so we can check our phones, we can check our app, and we can see what this unit is doing at the moment. Very crucial to set this up from the beginning, especially because all the extended warranties are conditional upon setting up monitoring. So that is most of the important settings when you first set it up. They're all essentially what you need by default. Something for you to look at, however, system. Make sure all of this stuff is correct for you, especially when you're setting up your time zones and language and all of that sort of stuff. So this is just some more general settings that show you how the unit behaves, and you might not set this up till later until you fully understand what's going on with the unit. Cool. Now we're going to go back out of there. The more advanced settings, which you can see here, this isn't actually a menu. This is just, once you click on it, you'll get prompted with a password, which you can get from us when you get to that point. And that allows you to access some more settings, which in the wrong hands can be dangerous. So we're not going to share that with you now. That's for your electrician. Another thing you can see here is the user log. This is essentially just everything that's happened recently on the inverter since it's been booted up. Information. This is where you can get your serial number. I'll probably get the editor to blur that one out. Otherwise, you can go into our app and you can have a look at our unit. Historical records. This is the long-term storage for all the different goings on in the inverter. You can actually see the BMS communication failure here. That was the test I did before to show you the error panel. That's everything you're gonna need on this setting panel. So hopefully that gives you a good overview of what's going on with the E4 monitor. If you have any more questions or you wanna have a look at some of the more advanced settings, please get in touch, send us an email, give us a call. We're always happy to help, as long as it's on the weekdays.